En unos segundos vas a escuchar una conversación completamente en inglés entre yo y una nativa de inglés llamada Charlie. Charlie es de Estados Unidos, es dueña de una academia de baile, está viajando a Latinoamérica con su esposo y obviamente habla un inglés perfectamente fluido y bonito, dado que es de Estados Unidos. Entonces, esta va a ser una gran práctica de escucha para ustedes, chicos. Y también de pronto darles una perspectiva interesante de las diferencias culturales que tenemos. A medida que pase la conversación, voy a hacer pausas y explicar ciertas expresiones, palabras, verbos, etcétera, que ella y yo usamos para que tú los puedas aprender también. Y lo único que tienes que hacer es sit back, relax, and enjoy, como decimos en inglés. Ahora, si tienes problemas para entender, no te preocupes. Vas a tener la opción de activar subtítulos, tanto en inglés como en español, como tú prefieras. Pero mi recomendación es que te desafíes un poco, empieza sin subtítulos o colocando subtítulos en inglés. Y si hay alguna parte de la conversación que no entiendes, puedes rebobinar y poner subtítulos en español. Si te gusta el video, por favor, recuerda darme un like y suscríbete al canal para que no pierdas futuros videos. Y más importante, para ayudarme a mí hacia mi visión de un Latinoamérica donde no hay una sola persona que no hable inglés y que todo el mundo tiene las mismas oportunidades de crecer en la vida. Espero que te guste. Yo soy Kalle Anders, tu coach de inglés y tu sueco favorito. Empecemos. So, thank you so much, Charlie,
yeah,
for being here with me.
My pleasure.
My pleasure. Una expresión súper típica de nativos de inglés que significa mi placer, pero realmente significa de nada o con mucho gusto. So, thank you so much, Charlie,
yeah,
for being here with me.
My pleasure.
Charlie. ¿Es that a nickname?
Nickname. A nickname es un apodo. Entonces, Charlie es realmente un apodo. Su verdadero nombre es Rachel, que es un nombre súper común en Estados Unidos, pero adoptó el nombre Charlie por esta razón.
¿Es that a nickname?
Yes. Yeah. It's a, like a very old nickname. So everybody calls me Charlie, but I lived in Germany for a while, and my real name is Rachel. And oh. I was in the eastern part, so a lot of people didn't speak English very well. So they called me Rachel, and yeah, that's very close to Rachem, which means like revenge.
Oh.
And it just didn't feel good.
Rachel no suena tan bien. En alemán significa venganza. Muy agresivo. Entonces, cambió su nombre a Charlie.
I lived in Germany for a while, and my real name is Rachel. And oh. I was in the eastern part, so a lot of people didn't speak English very well. So they called me Rachel. And yeah, that's very close to Rachem, which means like revenge.
Oh.
And it just didn't feel good,
yeah,
to be, you know, called, yeah, Rachel.
All right. So. And what brought you to Charlie?
I had a lot of nicknames. Rachel was like very popular name,
yeah,
when I was growing up. So I, yeah, always had nicknames anyways,
yeah,
because there's just so many of us.
It's kind of funny because Charlie is the translation of my name in Swedish to English.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So you'd have Carl and Charlie, typically.
Right.
And then in Swedish, you have Carl and Kalle. And my name is Kalle, which is the...
Okay.
So if whenever I talk to an American, for example, if they don't know, if they don't get my name, if they struggle a little bit, I just tell them, just call me Charlie. And it works.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what brought you to Latin America? For how long have you been here?
What brought you to Latin America? Brought es el pasado del verbo bring, traer. ¿Qué te trajo a Latinoamérica? ¿O qué te llevó a Latinoamérica? ¿Por qué fuiste a Latinoamérica? What brought you to Latin America?
So what brought you to Latin America? For how long have you been here?
Ooh, so we kind of are like snowbirds.
Ella dijo, we are kind of like snowbirds. Ella y su esposo. Somos pájaros de nieve. Esa es una expresión en inglés en Estados Unidos que significa una persona que vive en el norte, en el frío, que en invierno se mueve para el sur, donde el calor. Snowbird.
We kind of are like snowbirds. I'm from Boston. Actually, I'm originally from Maine, but I now live in Boston, and it's very, very cold in Boston in the winter, and it's a paradise here. So yeah, when it gets cold, I come here. So the last few years, we've been coming, you know, every time we come a couple more months.
Yeah.
This time we'll be here about 6 months,
yeah,
and it's looking pretty likely that we'll be here starting next year for a couple of years.
You and your partner.
Correct.
Who I know is American Dominican.
Correct.
All right.
Yeah.
What does that mean? Does that mean that he was born in the U.S. with Dominican parents, or he was born in Dominican Republic and moved to the U.S.?
Could mean either.
It could mean both.
In his case, he was born in the Dominican Republic,
yeah,
and came when he was like 8.
Okay.
And at this point, you know, he speaks Spanish. He's, you know, I think honestly though, he's more comfortable,
yeah,
with English.
Yeah. And how did you meet?
We're both dancers.
Really?
So we were actually professional partners before we became romantic partners.
Yeah.
And then we became business partners, and now we have a son and
wow.
we live here.
Wow. Where did you meet?
We met at a club, a dance club, a social club.
Yeah.
Just dancing.
Yeah.
In Cambridge.
Wow. So I wanted to ask you, what motivated you guys to come here? Because he's not from Colombia.
Right.
Had you been to Colombia before you came here, or had you been to Colombia before coming here?
¿Habías ido a Colombia antes de que vinieras esta vez?
Had you been to Colombia before you came here, or what was it that, you know, got your attention about Colombia?
What was it that got your attention about Colombia?
¿Qué fue que obtuvo tu atención de ir a Colombia?
Literalmente traducido.
Pero quería decir, ¿qué te trajo Colombia? ¿Qué te inspiró ir a Colombia?
What was it that, you know, got your attention about Colombia?
Right. He has a very good friend that's Paisa, that's from Medellin.
Yeah.
And he met him in Boston because he lived there for a long time. Esteban is his name. He met his wife actually in Boston as well, even though they're both from Medellin. And so they eventually moved back to Medellin, and he was always kind of trying to get Jonathan, that's my partner's name,
yeah,
to come and visit him. And so finally he did, and then he was like, oh yeah, no, this is exactly what he said it was going to be, amazing, incredible. And
yeah,
we just, you know, the first time we visited, we were just like, oh, we have to come back here forever.
Yeah. And that's your plan? Or are you going to travel a bit more, or are you going to stay here, settle down a little, or?
Settle down. Una expresión super común en Estados Unidos, bueno, en inglés como tal, que significa establecerse. Comprar casa, tener familia, establecerse en un lugar. Settle down.
Gonna stay here, settle down a little, or what's the grand plan?
Yeah, I mean, we're settling a bit. We finally got an apartment because just the runaround, especially with a son who's like, he's two now, so it just gets like, the needs get more intricate, and
yeah,
you know, we're just not as mobile.
Yeah.
And so we got an apartment, and we're currently renovating it. I'm like literally like covered in dust. I'm sorry if I leave your apartment.
Yeah, that's okay.
like Charlie Brown, I don't know.
It's covered in sweat anyways, because it's so hot in here.
It's the worst.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, the idea is that we'll sort of fix it up.
We will fix it up. Fix it up es un verbo frasal en inglés que significa arreglar. We will fix it up. Vamos a arreglarlo, el apartamento. Vamos a renovarlo, arreglarlo. We're gonna fix it up.
The idea is that we'll sort of fix it up,
yeah,
and be a little more comfortable.
Yeah.
And this will be sort of more our place. We'll go back to Boston because we have family there, and I have a dance company that I need to tend to, but...
What should people know about Boston? Because I'm obviously the stereotypical, you know, I just know the stereotypical things. Harvard,
yeah,
cold, the accent, Mark Wahlberg.
Yeah, yeah, which I don't have. I don't really have much of an accent. It's a beautiful city. This is a green city. Like,
yeah,
Medellin, you can't compare.
Yeah.
But for the States, Boston's a very green city. There's a lot of trees, a lot of parks.
Yeah.
You know, when it's like spring and summer and fall. And then it's covered in snow.
Yeah. Oh, I miss the snow.
I was going to say, you must be very familiar,
yeah,
with the snow.
I haven't seen the snow in 2 years or 3 years. And I just...
You don't get back?
I get back, but in the summer.
Okay.
Because not because of the, like, the heat or the temperature, but more so the darkness in winter.
Right.
It can be quite depressing. Whereas in summer, you know, in my city, the sun goes down at 11 p.m. So,
oh,
and goes up at 4 a.m. in the morning.
Oh my goodness.
So everyone's out, happy, just, you know,
sleep
enjoying life. Just, we have very good blinds back home.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah. So did you pick up Spanish in Boston?
Did you pick up Spanish in Boston?
Okay, empezamos desde cero. Cuando hacemos preguntas en inglés, usamos un verbo auxiliar, un verbo de ayuda. En este caso, el verbo do.
Do you pick up Spanish?
Y cuando queremos hacer preguntas en el pasado, simplemente conjugamos el do.
Did you pick up Spanish?
Ahora, to pick up Spanish significa aprenderse español en el camino. Okay? Es una expresión, to pick up. Aprenderse a la ligera, okay? En la calle.
consumiendo, hablando, conversando. Did you pick up Spanish in Boston? ¿Aprendiste español en Boston?
So, did you pick up Spanish in Boston? Or...
Well, I mean, in the States, you, like...
In the States. The States. Así se refiere normalmente a los Estados Unidos. The States. Los Estados. Tú puedes decir the U.S., USA, o the States. Cuando te refieres a los Estados Unidos en inglés. Incluso los americanos dicen America. America. The U.S. USA. The States. Todos significan lo mismo. Estados Unidos.
In the States, you like if you have to learn a second language.
Yeah.
Rarely does anyone actually learn, I would say, another language in the States, sadly. But
is it mandatory in school?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it is.
And still, people don't learn.
It's not really taken very seriously.
Yeah.
And I think you know, like, people accommodate Americans a lot, so the need isn't as strong.
Yeah.
And I think when there's less people around you that speak another language, the value of it is a lot lower.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's hard to even grasp the concept that you can't completely translate something and that there's more to gain from another language. So I did learn Spanish in high school.
I did learn Spanish or I learned Spanish es exactamente la misma cosa. En la segunda aquí tenemos conjugado el verbo learn en al pasado. Y en la otra aquí tenemos conjugado el verbo de ayuda, do. I did learn Spanish. I learned Spanish. Es exactamente lo mismo. Puedes usar ambos. ¿Cuál es la diferencia? I did learn Spanish es un poco más para enfatizar el hecho de que sí, yo sí aprendí español. Es la única diferencia.
So I did learn Spanish in high school. And I spent a little bit of time abroad, but not enough to like really pick it up well. And I've been kind of reviving it. Because of coming here, I actually learned Portuguese in between because I'm a samba dancer, so Brazilian samba dancer.
Oh, wow!
And there was like much more motivation.
Wow! Do you prefer samba to salsa or bachata?
They're all pretty equal for me. I mean, my company is a samba company, so performing wise, I'm always choreographing and performing samba.
Yeah.
But socials. There just isn't like a big social scene for samba, so I'm really used to just salsa and bachata, which is how I met my partner.
Yeah. I like bachata. It's simple. Two steps to the left, two steps to the right.
Yeah.
Can't go wrong.
Yeah. A lot of room to play there, too. It's nice. And simple.
Yeah.
Good.
I remember when I first got to Colombia and they were like, I went to a club and the beer just arrived. And I'm like, and then immediately they turned on this salsa song and everyone at the table just stood up and started dancing. And they were like, yeah, come on, you should dance with us. And I'm like, oh, no, let me please finish this beer. Or like five before I go out there. Very uncomfortable. But something that I really appreciate about the Latin American culture, like the openness and like, you know, life is fun. You know, it's supposed to be fun and very relaxed and enjoying themselves and just having a good time. Although there can be some cultural differences, too. Sure. That can be a bit of a shock.
Definitely.
Do you have any... Well, examples?
I mean, I'm European. I mean, imagine like time, just sense of time, punctuality.
Yeah, but I think Europeans and Americans are quite similar in that regard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that takes some adjusting. In all honesty, it's one of the reasons we like being here, though, because I get a little stressed about being on time.
Yeah.
And here, when I'm not on time, like...
It's not the end of the world.
It's not the end of the world. No es el final del mundo. No es gran cosa. Que llegas un poquito tarde. Ya tanto ella como yo estamos un poquito más acostumbrados de la vida latina. Tomarlo un poquito a la ligera. Llegamos, no necesariamente en punto, pero llegamos. Realmente a mí no me gusta para nada la impuntualidad aquí en Latinoamérica, pero es algo que he aprendido a manejar. Entonces, es una de las pocas cosas que no me gusta en Latinoamérica, que son muy pocas.
It's not the end of
like,
the world.
I just like walk myself through like, just calm down. Yeah. Like they're probably not even there, you know? So, you know, it really takes a toll on you if you're constantly concerned about it.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's something that reflects in just sort of the feel of the people here.
So yeah.
Like, yeah.
That's the thing you like the most about the culture here or?
No, but that was probably the thing I had to get, you know, like get used to.
Yeah.
I mean, I really like the life, sort of music.
Yeah.
That dance is sort of something that just comes with being alive. That's lovely.
Yeah.
I don't know how it is in Sweden. Do you guys have folk
we do
dances or something?
No, no, we don't dance. We dance with our hands like this.
Yeah,
listening to house music.
House, that's right.
Yeah,
yeah. So it's very, you know, that's a pretty American version of a relationship to music.
Yeah.
I love that. There's a warmth that the thing is, you know, the States is huge.
The States is huge. Los Estados Unidos es enorme. Huge, enorme, masivo.
You know, the States is huge.
Yes.
So you can go to places that are a lot warmer than Boston.
Yeah.
As far as, you know, how people treat you.
Do you think there's a correlation between like the weather and...
I wonder about that. I think about that and like spicy food also.
Yeah.
Although here they don't like spicy food.
Yeah.
But I feel like the warmer it gets, the more likely they'll eat spicy food.
Yeah. And the warmer and fun, more fun the people are as well.
Yeah.
Maybe. I don't know. Let's not talk too much about that because we have no idea, really.
What? That would play true for Brazil, I would say. You know,
yeah.
Like the warmer it gets, kind of the rowdier the party gets.
You've been to Brazil a lot?
You've been to Brazil a lot? Aquí estoy acortando una palabra. Have you been to Brazil a lot? Muy típico que los nativos de inglés también cortan palabras para hablar un poquito más rápido. Pero si estás consumiendo frases todos los días, lo que siempre les estoy diciendo, chicos, que consuman muchas frases. Van a interiorizar esta forma de hablar. Y cuando yo digo, you've been to Brazil a lot, inmediatamente lo vas a entender si estudias de esta forma.
You've been to Brazil a lot?
A decent amount, yeah. My company goes every year.
My company goes every year. Mi empresa va todos los años a Brasil. ¿Por qué dice goes y no go? Por ejemplo, decimos I go to Brazil. ¿Por qué no decimos my company go to Brazil? Porque my company se puede intercambiar por el sujeto it. Tenemos los sujetos I, you, he, she, it, we, they. Cuando el sujeto es he, she o it, agregamos una S al final del verbo en el tiempo verbal presente, en la cual estamos hablando en este momento. Entonces decimos, my company, it goes to Brazil every year. ¿Okay? En este caso, no simplemente agregamos una S, sino una E también, porque el verbo go es un verbo irregular, y no ponerle una E ahí sonaría un poquito raro, goose. Entonces decimos goes, se pronuncia con una Z, goes. My company goes to Brazil, mi empresa va a Brasil.
My company goes every year and I go once in a while.
Yeah. Brazil is cool, I like that too. What I really like about the culture here is the people are very familiar.
Nuevamente, la palabra is. La has escuchado un millón de veces. También se pronuncia con una Z. Is. Para sonar un poquito más nativo. Is.
Is. The people are very familiar. I mean, something, I don't know if you feel the same, but in my case, I really like that you're in such a different culture. And so that you get to adopt certain, you know, certain traits from that culture into your own. So. When I lived in Sweden, when I had never been to Latin America in my life, I was way less familiar. I never talked to my parents. I rarely gave gifts away because in Sweden, people don't give gifts. You know, we're very individual, very independent. And so if you give a gift to anyone in my family, they'll be like, why are you giving me a gift? It's weird.
Not even like at the holidays?
At the holidays, it's okay.
It's okay.
It's okay.
It's allowed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's weird, but I like that a lot.
Yeah.
So, and with your husband, how was that? But he's very Americanized.
He's super.
Because
he
was a child when he came to the US.
Yeah, he's more American than I am in some ways.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I mean, he's kind of an introvert and on the shyer side.
Yeah.
So, you know, if anyone's like all over someone, it's me on him.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that's more of just a personality thing.
Yeah.
But, I think his family is very warm.
Escucha la pronunciación nativa de inglés, nativa americana. Family, family. No decimos family o family, decimos family. Así se pronuncia, family, family. Trata de decirlo.
His family is very warm. You know, his mom's all over me, which is lovely.
Yeah.
But I also have a very warm family. Boston in general, though, the culture is actually, they're very nice people, but they're not gonna like here, you get off the elevator and you say bye. You say, I'll see you later.
Exactly.
It's like, that's if you say that to someone in the States, they're like, what do you mean? Like, I'm following me.
Yeah.
You know? So there's this friendliness and sort of like this lovingness that I find just super endearing here.
There's a friendliness that I find super endearing. Endearing es algo que inspira cariño. Que la gente es muy cálida aquí en Latinoamérica. Es algo que le inspira mucho cariño a Charlie. Y a mí es algo que me encanta. Por ejemplo, que se saludan en el elevador y al salir del elevador dices hasta luego. Como que nos vemos después. Cuando eso en Estados Unidos o en Europa sería muy raro decir. Pero aquí en Latinoamérica no. Y eso es algo que nos encanta como extranjeros llegando aquí. Esa calidez de las personas.
This friendliness and sort of like this lovingness that I find just super endearing here.
Yeah.
That you don't necessarily find where I'm from.
Yeah. What would you say? I mean, you've met a decent amount of Latin Americans traveling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What would you say to those people? Because I mean, how well is your Spanish?
Oh.
Más o menos.
Más o menos. Yeah.
Podríamos tener la conversación en español.
No.
No? Bueno, you understood that at least.
Sí, sí.
You understood that.
It's like a lot easier to understand than to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you, I assume you have interacted with a lot of Latin Americans that are learning English.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's your experience? Like, what do you have any advice for them or any tips or like on top of your head as a native speaker? Like, I'd love to hear your perspective on that. Because one thing that I always say to my audience, to my students is that you should never be afraid to speak. A lot of Latin Americans are a little bit ashamed of speaking due to accents, poor pronunciation, poor level, and they're sort of expected to have a good English. And I always tell them, like, you should never be afraid to talk or be ashamed of your English, because you're making an effort to talk. And if you actually talk to a native speaker and they listen to you, if you actually talk to a native speaker, they're gonna listen to you and they're gonna try to help you. They're never gonna make fun of you because you're actually making an effort to speak in their language. And I always tell them, like, the only one, because some of them are afraid to be made fun of by other people. And I tell them the only ones that are gonna make fun of you is gonna be other Latinos who don't speak English. So why would you care?
Why would you care?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Why would you care? ¿Por qué te importaría cuando las únicas personas que se van a burlar de ti de tu inglés son otros latinos que no saben inglés? Porque esa es la realidad, chicos. En mi experiencia, si alguien se burla de ti, de tu pronunciación, de tu pobre nivel de inglés, lo que sea, es otro latino que no sabe inglés. Y entonces, ¿para qué importarse? ¿Verdad? Imagínate si yo te hablara en español, pero un español súper básico, malo, pobre pronunciación, no te burlarías de mí, sino tratarías de ayudarme. ¿Cierto? Así es como funciona, así que no te preocupes por tu nivel bajo por ahora. Simplemente acepta que es una realidad, que es algo que estás trabajando. No tiene nada que ver con tu inteligencia o tu talento, el hecho de que tu nivel de inglés por ahora no es tan alto como quieres. Y simplemente sal y no tengas miedo de hablar con las personas.
So why would you care?
Why would you care?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe to keep, because I'm a bit of a perfectionist, which gets in the way.
It gets in the way. Esa es una expresión en inglés que significa que se pone en el camino, es un bloqueo, es algo que te bloquea para seguir adelante. Entonces, si yo digo, being a perfectionist gets in the way of becoming fluent in a language. Eso quiere decir, ser perfeccionista te bloquea para ser fluido en un idioma. Así que, don't let perfectionism get in the way. No dejes que el perfeccionismo te bloquee el aprendizaje.
Which gets in the way.
Yes.
And if you have that trait, maybe at least try and recognize that it's there and that it's not necessary, it's not helpful.
Mm.
And to let it go a little bit if you can. It's not an easy trait to sort of like slough off. But in light of that.
In light of that, significa en luz de eso, considerando esta cosa, da, da, da.
In light of that, maybe think about that what you're doing, no matter what level you're at, is something to be proud of. Like, whatever you're doing above speaking your native language is already a bonus. It's already possibly more than the person you're talking with. So even if it's lower than their level, you know, it's maybe more than what they're doing.
Yes.
So if you're, you know, feeling like ashamed or concerned, maybe remind yourself that, you know, you're doing something special. and extra.
Me encanta esa perspectiva que da aquí, que el hecho de que tú te esfuerzas para hablar inglés, probablemente estás haciendo más de la otra persona con cual estás hablando. Pronto esa persona ni siquiera está aprendiendo un segundo idioma y tú lo estás haciendo. Así que probablemente estás haciendo más que esa persona con quien estás hablando. Así que siéntate orgulloso siendo un estudiante de inglés, porque estás haciendo grandes cosas.
Whatever you're doing above speaking your native language is already a bonus. It's yes. already possibly more than the person you're talking with. So even if it's lower than their level,
yeah.
you know, it's maybe more than what they're doing. Yes. So if you're, you know, feeling like ashamed or concerned, maybe remind yourself that, you know, you're doing something special and yeah. extra.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I really like that.
That's I should do that for myself is what I should do.
Yeah.
Take my own advice.
I want to end this conversation with a game.
Oh.
And I have done a little bit of research. So you're from the Northeast.
Correct.
And you have, but you don't have a very strong accent.
I don't.
But I'm sure you know how to do one.
Oh, God.
So I have a sentence here that's kind of weird. And I would like you, let's play around a little bit. You're a native speaker. I'm sure you can do a normal American accent, a Northeastern accent.
Yeah? I'll try.
Let's try this. Here's a sentence right here. That one.
I can brain freeze. Oh, gosh. All right. So, hey, Bob, you're going to get a wicked brain freeze if you're slurping down that frappe. It's a race to the pot.
Yes.
So you're looking for Boston. Huh?
Yes. Oh, God. Let's start with a normal. Let's start by reading this sentence just normally, like you would.
Sure. Hey, Bob, you're going to get a wicked brain freeze if you're slurping that frappe like it's a race to the Pat's end zone.
Ok, estamos haciendo un desafío de acentos. Yo quiero que ella lea esta oración en varios diferentes acentos. Entonces, esta oración es muy típico del noroeste de donde ella es, de Boston. En esta oración he puesto muchísimo slang, muchas palabras y expresiones que se usa justamente ahí en Estados Unidos. Entonces significa, hey Bob, vas a tener un gran dolor en tu cabeza. Brain freeze significa que el cerebro se congela. ¿Qué típicamente pasa cuando tomas mucha cosa fría, comes mucho helado frío en muy poco tiempo, cierto? Entonces significa, hey Bob, vas a congelar tu cerebro si sigues tomando ese frappe, ese frappuccino, como si fuera una carrera a la zona final de los Pats. Los Pats son los Patriots, es el equipo de fútbol americano de Boston o del noroeste. Y el end zone es la zona final del campo donde se meten los goles en fútbol americano. Entonces es una expresión súper típica de este lugar en Estados Unidos. Y ahora vamos a probar si ella puede leer esta oración en diferentes acentos. Vamos a ver.
Hey, Bob, you're gonna get a wicked brain freeze if you're slurping that frappe like it's a race to the Pat's end zone. So that was sort of the way I talk. So my family is from New York.
Yes.
And I was we moved to Maine, which has its own accent, and now I live in Boston.
Yeah.
So I think that's why I have a super neutral accent. I will try.
Yes. Now the Boston accent.
Because there'll be some Bostonians that are like, that's not Boston. All right.
No worries. No people from Boston are watching
Maybe
these
not.
Videos.
It's the wrong target. All right. Hey, Bob, you're going to get a wicked brain freeze if you're slurping down that frappe like it's a race to the Pat's end zone.
I love that. And I'm pretty sure.
It on it,
I'm pretty sure to most people it sounds the same. All right, let me read this in Swedish for you. Hey, Bob, you're going to get the wicked brain freeze if you keep slurping that frappe like it's a race to the Pat's end zone. You see, guys, I have actually trained my own accent. I didn't speak like this when I first started speaking English either, so you see? All right, let's do a southern one.
Oh, God. You got more? All right. That sentence, too?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I gotta practice on something else first.
Southern accent, which is like Texas.
Come on down, y'all. Hey, Bub. Oh, God.
They don't
say wicked. That's the Northeast. That's actually very mean.
Okay.
So how would they even? Well, come on down. Get some chicken.
Oh, Lord. That's amazing.
All right. Hey, Bub. You're going to get a wicked brain freeze if you keep slurping down that frappe like it's a race to the Pat's end zone.
Oh, my God. You sound like a... like a lovely grandmother.
Mm.
I don't know.
Like I'm gonna get some sweet tea for you.
Yeah. All right, what else do we got? Okay, let's do, I'll do the Medellin Spanish version.
Hey, Bob, you're gonna get a wicked brain freeze if you keep slurping that frappe like it's a race to the Pat's end zone. ¿Cómo estás?
All right, let's do Californian.
Oh.
That one's easy, no? It's lazy. They speak... They kind of sound like a little preppy.
Yeah, well, I need to, like, think of... But I gotta hear it first.
You didn't expect this, right?
I wasn't. I wasn't given any cheat sheets. Let me see. Cool man. Oh, God. What's like a phrase they would use? Just help me out. Give me a phrase that would be like typical so I can like...
Yeah, you're asking the wrong guy. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, man.
Yeah, I love that. You can start like that. Yeah, man.
10. Oh, God. Hey, Bob. God. Hey, Bob, you're going to get a wicked... No, hold on. I gotta...
Yeah.
I'm not...
No worries. We have plenty of time.
Perfect.
And plenty of memory in those memory cards.
I'm thinking, like, L.A., because yeah. That's the most... Or I could go, like, very valley.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, my God.
Yes. Use that.
Oh, my God. Like, really? You're going to do that? Hey, Bob, you're going to get a wicked brain freeze.
That's amazing.
If you keep slurping down, just switched. If you keep slurping down that frappe, like it's a race to the Pat's end zone. No.
That's really good.
It's very stereotypical. Wow. It's probably offensive.
It's probably, but, you know, whatever. It's fun. It's kind of like a flamboyant tone to the... To the Californian accent?
That I think like the women have kind of a more shrill, like, yeah, expressive, and the men is more of like, whoa.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Like they're stoned all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which they might be.
Yeah, which they probably are. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for taking your time to do this with me. It was amazing.
Ok, genial. ¿Cómo te fue? ¿Te gustó esta conversación? Cuéntame aquí en los comentarios abajo si pudiste entender, si te gusta este estilo de entrevistas y explicaciones, si aprendiste algo de valor aquí en este video. Y si te gusta este formato de video, de pronto tienes un invitado, una invitada que quisieras ver aquí conmigo. Dame recomendaciones. Y por favor, no olvides regalarme un like y suscríbete al canal si todavía no lo hayas hecho para ayudarme hacia mi visión de un Latinoamérica donde no hay una sola persona que no hable inglés y que todo el mundo tiene las mismas oportunidades para crecer en su vida. Pero antes de ir, quiero mencionar que tenemos una prueba de 2 semanas de mi curso de inglés. En mi curso enseño inglés a través de historias, que es muy parecido a cómo aprender a través de conversaciones. Súper efectivo. Es un método mucho mejor que estudiar de forma tradicional, un montón de reglas gramaticales, clases aburridas, leyendo libros de textos viejos, etc. Así que aquí abajo en la descripción voy a poner un enlace para la página de compra. Ahí puedes ver toda la información, precios, planes de pagos, testimonios y resultados de otros estudiantes. Y ahí también en la página vas a ver que tenemos otra garantía, que quiere decir que si sigues estudiando después de las 2 semanas de prueba, también garantizamos la fluidez. Garantizamos que cuando terminas el curso, sea cuando sea, tú avanzas por él a tu propio ritmo. Pronto lo terminas en 4, 6, 8 meses, no importa. Cuando lo terminas, garantizamos que eres fluido en inglés, o si no lo eres, te devolvemos el doble de lo que pagaste y te damos clases privadas ilimitadas conmigo hasta que lo seas. Así de seguro estoy de que este curso te va a funcionar y va a ser el último curso que necesitas tomar en tu vida para ser fluido en inglés. Revisa toda la información aquí abajo. Espero que te haya gustado este video. Cuídate muchísimo y nos vemos en los siguientes videos. Chao.